You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome to the Sociology of Work. My name is Sergio Soto, and this is our first broadcast for this semester. This is a class, and this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. So if you're flipping through the channels, or if you just joined this program, we'll talk a little bit about what's available. So again, this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This fall, we will be broadcasting four classes. Communication 365, Introduction to Public Relations. That's on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. Labor 412, Labor Law. You might have just watched it. It's on Saturdays from noon to 1:40 p.m. This course, Sociology 315, Sociology of Work. It's on Saturdays, of course, today, unless you're watching it, delayed or whatnot, from 1:50 to 3:30. So make sure you clear your schedule until 3:30 right now. Anyway, science, math, and technology, 3:12, natural disasters, fun, right? On Sundays from noon to 2 p.m. So if you're wondering about this program, if you have completed the first 2 years of college, right, community college or at a university, you could earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of these courses you need to complete for your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then we'll start all over again. So if you like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website at appliedstudies.tv. Or call 1-866-278-6789. Okay, so now you know why we have this class. So let's talk about what we're gonna discuss. Now, although this is a course, the whole community is welcome to join. So you don't have to be enrolled in this course to, you know, call in and provide a comment or text us what your feelings are about what we're discussing. Now, the great thing about the sociology of work is that we all work, right? One of the first things we're gonna discuss is that our occupation, you know, is something that we need, especially in our society, right? In order to get what we need, we have to participate in the economy, and most of us exchange our labor for a wage, right? You know, that's why we say labor is a commodity. Now, that doesn't mean everything you do, you know, every kind of work you do is paid, right? There are some things we do, some work we do because we like it, right? So an occupation is one thing and work is the other, but generally in our society, we fold them together. And when you say, oh, what do you do, for a living, or where do you work? We usually think of our occupation. And, you know, as we go on, we'll talk about why that's important and how it helps create social order in some cases, right? As far as the course, this is your lecture for those of you who are taking it for a grade. We'll use Blackboard to submit assignments and join our general discussions. But for the most part, I'm going to leave that to the syllabus. You know, my contact information is there. But again, everyone who's watching this course right now, whether you worked for a wage or not, whether you're of working age or not, has something to contribute, right? What are your perspectives? You know, how does it affect your family? And we're going to find that work really, you know, sometimes we can feel that it chains us to some things, right? Maybe you can't go out, or maybe, you know, you couldn't go out the night before because you had to work early, or it decides where you live, right? You know, whether, you know, because of distance, because of income, and so on. So this is what, you know, our first piece of lecture will be, you know, this is where we're going to begin. Work, why it matters to us, right? For most of us, you know, even those of you who are taking this class, right, the main purpose that, well, the main reason that you're in this class is to build that social capital so you can get a higher paying job, so you can get that job that you rather have, or maybe to, you know, earn a promotion within, you know, an organization that you're already part of, right? So, you know, that's a choice that has been influenced by the way our society works, right? You know, when we talk about an economy is just the way society kind of distributes the goods and services, right? And, you know, work is very important to us, again, because we sell our labor. You know, we organize our day around what we do, right? Now, we talked about where you live, but where you have to be, right? Later on, we'll talk about time and how time is, you know, essential for synchronizing everybody's activities. Like, for example, some of you had to clear your table for the day, I guess, or, you know, had to talk to your boss, you know, as far as, you know, whether you can, you know, take this class or not. But, you know, we all, including myself, showed up at 1:50 in order to, you know, for all of you to listen in, but for me to lecture, because, you know, this is what I do for work. This is my occupation, right? This is what I exchange for, you know, money. Anyway, so, not sure what that is, but anyhow, so again, events are planned around, you know, our assumed standard work schedule. Think about when you wake up in the morning, right? Chances are you wake up at a certain time so you can get ready and commute to work. Now, most of us have dealt with this all our lives. You know, you went to school, that's a type of work. It's not, you know, it's not an occupation, but you still had to rearrange your whole life according to that. And one of the things is that, you know, work will consume most of our adult lives, right? As we go through this class, we'll learn about the social relationships that develop within the workplace. And, you know, there's a very good reason why, you know, we make friends in, you know, school. And, well, I should rephrase it. Why most of our friends come from school when we're young, or most of our friends we get to know at the workplace, right? Occupation also provides a sense of identity, right? For example, we'll talk about status, right? Who we are. Like if someone asks me, okay, Sergio, who are you? Well, I'm a number of things, but one of the things I am, you know, is a sociologist, right? Or a lecturer, an educator, a teacher. Not a TV personality, obviously, but, you know, it's who we are. It's how we center ourselves and we center our understanding of what or who, what our role is in the world and who depends on us and how we feel about ourselves, right? We'll talk about prestige, right? Like some of you, you know, are familiar with, like, say, you know, the dating scene or something to that effect, right? Some people, you know, why do people lie about what they do? Well, part of it's because of prestige, right? And we'll kind of ask these questions. Why are some jobs more prestigious than others, right? Although, you know, some custodians make as much or more as, you know, educators or, you know, teachers, right? Why is one seen as more desirable than the other, right? Mostly because that prestige and that assumed responsibility that, you know, educators take on in this society. It all, you know, work is also a place where we interact with each other, right? We mentioned this before, but, you know, it's no, you know, mystery that people really attach themselves to the folks that they work with, right? You know, in some places people will say, oh, my workplace is like my second family. Or maybe, you know, you hate everyone you work with, right? There's real reasons, you know, those things come about and they absolutely affect who we are, right? Working in a stressful environment will influence other parts of your life. You know, this is clear for everyone, right? Even those, you know, those of you taking this class, even though, you know, you're not getting paid to do it, the work that I assign or that your other instructors assign will, you know, have an emotional effect on you. Maybe it's going to stress you out, you know, you'll lose sleep over it. But see, that's all related to, again, work. So, you know, sometimes they say this, like sociologists deal in the obvious, right? But that's the nice thing about this course and why everyone, you know, is able to either tweet a response or question in, a comment in, call in, email us, because we all have a shared understanding of what work is. Heck, for most of our lives, we've been prepared. Like when we were young, we were prepared to enter the economy. That's what school's for, right? They prepare you to take a role in the economy, right? And by they, I mean the, you know, institution of education, right? And one of the things that, especially in this election cycle, that we hear so much about is this unemployment. But unemployment right now is a global epidemic, and we're going to watch a film or a short video about that. But, you know, some of the uprisings around the world or some of the dissatisfaction within our own nation is directly connected to unemployment, right? When young people can't be independent, right? Say you're a young person, but your job is underpaying you, or you don't have a job and you're trying to go to school, right? And you can't move out, you know, you internalize that, right? Or maybe you're a parent, right? Again, this is how work influences your status. You know, you'd like to get your child that new, you know, Xbox or PlayStation, but you can't, you know, the money doesn't, you know, align the right way. You know, that affects you internally, that, you know, gives you perspective. But anyway, you know, not having a job, you know, you can think about how our society values it. You know, most people are seen as failures if they don't, right? But anyway, this is the first, well, actually, before we go to that, Hakeem just wrote in. Yeah, anyone can write in, absolutely. So thank you for writing. You're the first, Hakeem. Okay, so he comments, work matters in the U.S. as many of us define who you are by the type of work we do, right? In Europe, many view work as a way to get money and buy things. I agree that work is how we live, right? So there, Hakeem is providing a cultural perspective, right? And absolutely, in the United States, you know, we obsess about what others do and what we do and how we, you know, kind of wear that on our sleeve. So before we go on, you know, we're going to talk about work in a sociological perspective. We're going to go over some, you know, basic sociology, just so everyone is on the same page. But we're going to take a short, we're going to watch a short video called Global Youth Unemployment Epidemic, and then kind of deconstruct that as we go on. So let's take a look at that, and we'll be right back.
Well, as we watch protests and revolutions unfold in Tunisia and Egypt, we have to look at the role that young people have played. Young people that make up nearly 30% of the population in many Middle Eastern countries, who are educated and increasingly unemployed. But it's not just a Middle Eastern problem. You see, it's global. From the U.S. and Europe to the Middle East, North Africa, even China, an entire generation now is being coined as lost, disaffected, living in waithood. So can the global economy recover fast enough to create jobs for all of them? Or will they simply lose out and be skipped over? Well, joining me from our studio in New York to discuss it is Gregory White from the Business Insider. Greg, thanks so much for joining us. Now, like I said, this really has become a global issue. And how much of it can we say is based solely on the fact that but there just simply aren't enough jobs for all the young, educated people that are ready to go out there?
Well, a lot of it does have to do with the global slowdown. I mean, we've experienced a large recession over the past several years, and there just aren't jobs there because the demand isn't there for the end product. But a lot of it has to do with structural problems within governments around the world. And by that, I mean that they are inefficiently run, that they're ill-designed, that there's too large a public sector, too small a private sector, and you can't really experience the growth that's needed to get these people back into work.
Now, what about if we talk about, you know, the growing disparity, too, between young and old? There is this huge gap right now. We have so many baby boomers that are aging, that are really clinging on to their jobs. Can we have any hope in at least thinking that, you know, maybe a few years from now the baby boomers will start retiring and then all of these positions are going to open back up?
Well, one of the big problems is that when the baby boomers retire, they'll be spending less money. And if they're spending less money, then that means that there's going to be less demand for, you know, everything in the economy, from financial services to food at supermarkets to clothes as well. So maybe health, medical services would be something that would go up. But other than that, it's going to really have a negative impact, the retirement of baby boomers on unemployment, not a positive one.
Oh, great. So basically, unless you want to be a nurse or a doctor, you're screwed for the future. That just sounds fabulous. But, you know, also let's expand it to see what we've seen happening in Tunisia, in Egypt. You know, we've seen a lot of young people now that are protesting. We've seen revolutions unfold. We even saw in London earlier this year massive protests over tuition hikes. Why do you think that we see this happening really everywhere else except for here in the U.S.? I mean, we've seen a few protests in California, especially, you know, in Berkeley and in Oakland, but not on the same scale.
Well, certainly what you saw in Tunisia and Egypt is a little bit different because you also have food price inflation there, and things are much worse there than they are for, you know, the general unemployed young person in the United States. In London, you have an activist population in the city that's able to take advantage of those opportunities they have to them and protest and get out on the street against these measures that directly impact them and people younger. So that makes sense there. But in the U.S., you've seen the U.S. government, you know, kind of flood the market with cash for these kids coming out of school. And one of the other things the U.S. government does is they've eased the rules around getting student loans. So if you're still in school and you're still taking on more and more debt, it doesn't really matter that you're unemployed if you have that, you know, can get that graduate degree. The big problem is going to come when all of these people come out of school and they have graduate degrees and there's still no jobs.
And that's one of the problems that China also is especially having right now, is they simply have too many people with too many diplomas in their hands and nowhere to really put them. But let's talk about psychologically the way that this will have an effect on this generation too, because you have a lot of people that are, I loved this term, the Business Week had used, are in waithood, which is that you get out of college, maybe then you live with your parents and you're kind of just waiting for something to happen. It gives people the notion that, you know, finding a good job depends less so on hard work and more on good luck. So are they permanently going to be stuck in that rut, in that type of mindset?
Well, it certainly screws up the heads of a lot of people when you get put in this situation. If you're 2-3 years out of employment, out of school, or even just one, you begin to think that there's no job opportunities out there for you, and then you start to lower your expectations as to what job you'll take. And if you have that amongst a large cut of the youth unemployed, then you're going to have an economy that's kind of lowered its expectations on what it's going to eventually get, which is not good for a country, certainly not good for the United States when it's trying to grow its way out of the problems it has with the deficit. So this is a dangerous thing, absolutely.
So then, you know, at the same time, could you say almost that having this structure, this cushion, where, you know, people that get out of school and can still live comfortably, live off their parents, is going to hurt the U.S. more than other nations, because, you know, we're going to fall back in terms of innovation and technology and progress if we just start sitting in our own, you know, lazy filth?
Well, it's sort of hard to say, you know, because there's good and bad things about it, right? There's better for people to be in their parents' basement than out on the street. But at the same time, you're right. I mean, if people get discouraged and they're spending all this time not doing anything, then it's going to have a negative impact in the long run. But what else do you do? I mean, as a government, what else do you do than provide health care or, you know, a little extra cash and unemployment insurance to your population until at least something comes back in the economy and these people can find jobs? There's really no other choice.
Yeah. Well, it's definitely, like I said, a global epidemic, and I feel like it's something people should be paying more attention to. We hear so much about the unemployed around the world in the U.S., and maybe there's just that thought that young people have so much time, you know, before they really have to find a job and start saving for retirement. But we will have this lost generation or lost decade if something doesn't happen soon. Greg, thanks so much for joining us.
Okay, so welcome back. You know, as we explored in that video, we explored a lot of ideas related to values, expectations. You know, one of the things that was brought up is that young people aren't finding the employment that was promised to them when they enter school. But the other part, you know, that didn't get as much attention is, you know, some folks can't afford to retire, or what happens when people, you know, how work is tied to the economy. Now, this video was about a year old, but some of the questions that were brought up in it are still very valid. So please call in. You know, we're going to go through some comments that came in during that break. Whenever we have a video, it's a good time to kind of reflect on what we've discussed and, you know, to call in or write in. So Robert, you know, we'll start off with Robert. Would you say there is a merit to the basic premise that there are two basic cultural predispositions? Some work to live, e.g. Europeans, whereas we live to work. Well, we'll talk about that perspective as we move on. You know, I'll really go into detail, I guess, with when we talk about Max Weber's Protestant ethic. But our value system, our ideology, how we see ourselves as an individual is really tied into how we think of work, right? You know, one of the things that we'll explore in this class is that, you know, as Americans, we tend to be overworked. We work more than everyone else, but that doesn't necessarily mean that we, as individuals, necessarily, reap the benefits of that. You know, one of the things I'll argue is, you know, something to the effect that some of the folks who work the most or hardest in our society often aren't the ones who reap the most benefit from it, right? Some of you may feel like that way, right? You might work three jobs, but feel you still can't get out of the, you know, class level that you're in. You know, we have individuals who, you know, work, you know, two or three, you know, minimum wage jobs and don't earn as much as someone working, you know, one, you know, well-paid job. So, you know, those dynamics are, you know, something we definitely will explore. Margaret writes in. Oh, let's go to Margaret. I'm a baby boomer who remembers a similar situation during the late 70s and early 80s. There was a lot of unrest in the U.S. and in Europe due to political distrust and the lack of jobs for young folks, right? So, you know, as a young person, I remember my first economics class, you know, boom and bust. So, you know, one of the arguments is that this is cyclical and maybe this is supposed to happen, right? You know, we'll explore some of these ideas again. You know, this is definitely a plug to keep watching this class, but this idea might alarm some of you. You know, maybe there, you know, the economy relies on some individuals being unemployed, right? Because again, labor is a commodity that is bought and sold, and you can imagine, you know, we all understand what demand does to a price, right? It raises the price. But when demand is low, right? Or when the supply is low, I should say, when the supply is low, that raises the demand. But when the supply is high, you know, that drops I'm getting mixed up. So that happens with live TV. Okay, let's start over. Okay, when supply is low, right, the price goes up. Okay, think of, you know, when iPhones come out, right? That's why people will shell out like $700, $600 for one, right? Because they know by the end of the week, maybe they'll run out and you won't be the cool kid on the block. But if there were, you know, was, you know, a abundancy of them, right? That's when things go on sale and the price drops. The same thing with labor, right? If you can't find someone to fill in the job that you are advertising for or a specialist to work, you know, in that field, you know, you have to make it more attractive. You have to raise the wages, right? That's kind of one of the reasons why it's argued that doctors earn so much, right? You know, you're going to dedicate 8 years, 10 years of your life to get a degree and your, medical credential. So you should be rewarded. You know, that's a carrot on the stick. But other jobs that almost anyone can do, like dishwasher, these skilled jobs, you know, don't earn as much because, again, the market is rife with people who are able to fill those roles. So, you know, we'll be exploring that as well. So next comment, Shauna writes in. First, she says, hello, everyone, and hello, Shauna. I believe this is a great class. I don't disagree. So I'm comfortable with knowing that work is at least 75% of my life. This is how we grow through communication and what we offer the company, right? Assuming we work with a company. But yes, you know, work, you know, one thing that we're going to explore is that, you know, we've, as humans, we've always worked, right? The big transition is working for a wage, right? We'll talk about the Industrial Revolution next week, where, you know, folks went from a family-based economy where the family produced most of the things that were needed. But, you know, actually we'll start off with hunting and gathering all the way back then, but we'll just talk about that today. But, you know, humans have always worked. But, you know, having actual occupations is something that is relatively new in the course of human history. So definitely, you know, there have been shifts. And, you know, there's shifts today, right, on how we perceive work or how we work, right? We live in a globalized world. We're more and more connected, you know, depending on the field you're in, to technology, or maybe more displaced, right? One of the things that we'll talk about is, you know, what happens if we all go into this virtual workspace, right? Or what does it mean when people refer to a service-based economy instead of one based on manufacturing? Jim writes, quite the conundrum. If baby boomers retire, will this create some jobs? But the economy will go down. If baby boomers keep working, the economy continues to go up, or at least maintain. So, but less jobs, right? So it is a conundrum, right? One of the expectations is that as folks retire, new individuals, you know, fill those roles, you know. But, you know, if you look at some other countries like Japan, where their fertility rate or the rate at which they have children isn't maintaining the size of their society, so they're more and more dependent on immigration. So you know, they need, you know, what happened, you know, you need a certain amount of young people working in the society, but you also need some of those places that, you know, the generation before, you know, held, right? But again, like I mentioned before, one of the realities is that, you know, what people projected to retire with, if they were saving or, you know, or they depended on Social Security, you know, that's not enough anymore. So some folks don't have the option of retiring anymore, right? So, you know, there's a good chance that they'll work to, you know, to the last breath, if you will. Fred writes in, I've never asked anyone what they do for a living. I think it's personal and a rude question. Am I old-fashioned? Well, no, I mean, there's different, you know, cultural guidelines. Some people aren't comfortable telling other folks what they do. Or some people just shout it out from the rooftops because of, you know, their status, right? You know, when people are meeting for the first time, you know, one of the safe places to kind of discuss or, you know, kind of get, you know, create a mutual, you know, discussion topic is, you know, to ask someone what they do for a living. So I guess, you know, just to kind of give it a general answer, and this is a good segue to discuss culture, right, is that it varies by culture, but it also varies by, you know, the kind of relationship or situation that you're in with the person, right? If it's a stranger, you know, maybe you wouldn't ask that right away. If it's someone you want to get to know, yeah, eventually you'll ask. Or, you know, if you have other intentions, right, if you're dating, you know, that gets asked all the time, right? That's how folks measure a potential mate's viability, you know. So anyway, you know, things that we'll explore. So next we want to kind of discuss work in the sociological perspective. We've kind of explored some of these ideas already. When we talk about the sociological perspective, we're looking at the social structure that is behind everything. You know, we all are used to identifying behavior or, you know, someone's actions or why things are the way that they are or how we know what we know. But rarely do we kind of pick it apart and, you know, really think about what is creating all this, right? So as sociologists, this is something that we strive to do. So there is an individualistic, we'll first talk about the individualistic perspective of work. So now I'll read this to get it right. Most people view work as an individual effort, right? You know, I do this, you do that, right? So you can kind of think of it as though everyone exists in a bubble. through this perspective, right? And again, most people view that work is an individual effort and separated from other parts of their lives. However, work is influenced by macro level forces, you know, these big social structures and institutions, something like the economy, right? That shape the skills we use, the wages we receive, and the opportunities available. The private life and the work life do not exist in separate worlds. So this is the myth of separate worlds, right? You can think about the family, right? The family and work do not exist in separate worlds, right? They overlap, they influence each other. For example, the opportunities that if you have children, right? We'll assume, you know, in this scenario, someone has a child, the opportunities that you can afford your child will be influenced by the resources you have. The resources you have access to, you know, usually money, things like that, are influenced by, you know, work, wages, the economy, right? You know, to bring in the sociological imagination, right? If you want more on sociological imagination, you know, I'll be teaching a 101 class, so you can take both of them at the same time or watch both classes. But, you know, that's where we kind of make a connection between our personal troubles and public issues, right? Now, we were just talking about or discussing unemployment, right? One way to kind of think about this individual perspective is that for the most part, when we think of someone unemployed, or at least, you know, maybe 8 years ago or 10 years ago when the economy was doing a little better, we thought of individuals without a job as, you know, suffering from their personal failures, right? Maybe they weren't working hard enough at their other jobs, so they developed a bad reputation. So whenever they put references down, they always called back and said, oh, Jim's a terrible worker. I'm not picking on Jim, his first name that came up, but okay, so-and-so's a terrible worker, right? But not so much today. You know, for the most part, we all understand that the economy isn't really where we'd like it to be. That a lot of different types of jobs, right, that were extremely, we could consider them good jobs or part of a healthy economy have, you know, gone away from, you know, our nation through outsourcing or offshoring, or their trades or fields that are no longer desirable or as highly sought in our economy, right? You know, you kind of think of like something like a travel agent. Like maybe 15 years ago, you would see like a travel agent office every couple miles, but you know, those are fewer and far between nowadays because most folks kind of book their own trips and make their own plans using the internet, right? So we're kind of pulling a lot of things from the, you know, economy and things like that. You know, we're really taking a, when we talk about a macro outlook, we're looking at, you know, we're taking the social structure into account. So we're kind of, taking a look at the big picture, if you will. Right. So again, you know, this idea doesn't, you know, work doesn't exist in separate worlds. You know, something again that's very clear. Your work life will, influence your family life. Family life will influence work life. Right. Just to throw something going the other way. Right. With family, and this is kind of like the gender division of labor. How women, you know, are, you know, one of the inequalities women tend to feel if they have a family. Right. If your child gets sick at school, they usually call mom. You know, mom might have to leave work, and maybe, you know, this happens frequently or infrequently, or maybe because of the stigma that mom might have to do that, she gets passed up by a promotion, right? So again, you know, it's overlapping. So again, the sociological perspective is personal experiences are best understood by examining the broader social context. Okay, so that's a sociological perspective, right? We'll also talk about culture. Right? Culture is a meaning system that attaches individuals to work, harnesses their commitment, and directs their effort. Now, we're going to get ready to watch a short kind of clip to kind of demonstrate culture and culture shock. It's not so much related to work, but I think it does a very good job at kind of helping us reflect on some of the norms and values. Norms are the rules in our society, or how things we do that, you know, rules that regulate behavior or how we think about, you know, values, how we think about things, it helps kind of illustrate that culture is all around us, right? Work has a very, you know, going back to this European American perspective, you know, in the United States, work has a very particular, you know, cultural link, right? It's, you know, especially with our identity. It's something that everyone's expected to do. When you don't do it, you're seen as someone who is either failing within the system or, you know, we have a simpler word for it, lazy, right? Actually, before we get into it, you know, we'll try to get the comments as they come in. Margaret writes in, most of the baby boomers I work with cannot afford to retire. We expect to work for another 15, 20 years, right? You know, and, you know, that's unfortunate, really. You know, science keeps pushing forward, you know, the standard life expectancy. So is it really so you can have, you know, 20 more years after you retire at 65 or 20 more years of leisure or 20 more years of work? Robert also writes in, will you at some point in the course address the anti-ethical nature of interaction between supply side economics and globalization and their negative effects on national and communal best interests? Yes, right? We will. It's going to be towards the back end of the class. What globalization means, right? Just to give you, some of you who aren't familiar with this term, basically we are participating, now I'm assuming most everyone is living here in, or is somewhere here in Los Angeles, but if not, you know, your whole lives, you know, everyone's lives are kind of influenced by globalization. You know, maybe the television or computer monitor that you're watching this on is made elsewhere, right? Unless you're watching a really old TV, chances are your TV was made in Mexico, China, or think about where it's designed, Japan. You know, a good example is Apple, right? If you have an Apple product, like an iPad or something, it says designed in Cupertino, which is in California, right? But it's manufactured in China, right? We'll talk about Foxconn and things like that a little bit as we go. But, you know, one of the, you know, one set of arguments is that, you know, we're hyper-globalizing, that this is a good thing, you know, a high tide raises all ships. So even though things are kind of in a rut here, they're really for the better globally. But then there's the other side that says, okay, well, you know, it's just spreading exploitation, you know, only a few are winning more than others. We'll also look at the cultural effects, you know, we'll discuss hegemony. And we'll actually even kind of challenge this idea of globalization. You know, it's not really anything new. It's just the pace that we're experiencing it today, right? You know, globalization has always been a reality. If you remember from your history classes, like the Silk Road and things like that, right? That was, you know, trade between states across long distances, right? But as I was, you know, talking about Los Angeles, one way we kind of experience and see globalization every day is with these containers, you know, on the back of trucks, right? You know, Los Angeles is a gateway, you know, in and out for goods, right? So we definitely are part of that whole system. Everyone's connected, right? So anyway, we'll take a quick look at a video about culture shock, Sudanese refugees, and coming to America, right? And the reason for this is just to kind of, you know, introduce some of you to who, you know, are watching at home, maybe have never taken a sociology class, to this cultural perspective that even though we're dealing with work, will always be in the background. So let's take a look at that now. It's about 4 or 5 minutes, and then we'll be back.
People go to the river with containers to draw water for themselves.
For
busing, you want to take busing.
There's something called apartment. I've never had, met, and I've never seen it.
Shower. How does it look like? Shower.
I've never used electricity, so I imagine that it is really very hard for me to do that.
And in the United States, we had this only one wife. These things are going to affect us.
The food we got in the flame was not really good as what we used to be eating in They say Akakuba.
It tastes like soap, you know, that small one. I don't know if it's soap or petrol. I just see because people say it's food, you know, eat. But when I try to taste, it's like soap actually.
And even now I cannot tell. Yeah? Is that meat? Is that milk? Is that ghee? I cannot tell.
Potatoes. In Africa, I use just to cook it, you know, and boil it, okay? They make different, they make it in a different way. Mm-hmm. They call it chips, you know, they slice it, they fry it, mm-hmm. and they put it in a bag, okay?
Mm-hmm. It's ready.
It's ready cooked, yes. Try it, it's yours. Everything here has belonged to you. We do not throw things away through the window. We put here, you press this, you push,
this
goes down, right.
Is this a food?
These are donuts.
These are colored sprinkles that we decorated with. You want to try one? Want to taste it?
Thank you.
Good. It looks like beer.
Huh? Seems like you're fascinated.
Never.
What? That is Senecos. The Senecos.
And how does it connect it with the verse of Jesus Christ? I think many of us have so many questions to ask, but I think we have few people to answer them.
Everything is different. Everything is different.
It's kind of irritating because
people know you're from Africa. They say, where are you from Africa? Yes.
Some people, they say, do you live in the forest? Nobody's born in the forest. You can't live in the forest. You have to live in a house.
In the United States, people are not friendly. You can find somebody walking in the street by himself, you know, don't even talk, you know. You cannot go to the house of somebody whom you don't know, though you are all Americans. You call the police, why this guy come to my house and I don't know him. But in Sudan, they can ask you, have you got lost? Are you new to this place? They can ask you. You say, I'm new to this place, they can show you where you are. You can even talk with them. It is important we ask them, how do people work in this area? How do people feel when you ask somebody, now can you show me a way? How do he feel, you know? That's difficult, you cannot even ask him because these are different people. That's really difficult, I don't know. How are we going to be acquainted with this life, really? It's a great change, actually.
Merchants in Daniel and Panther's neighborhood have filed complaints with the local police in Pittsburgh. They feel intimidated by the boys entering their stores in large numbers. So a meeting was called to advise the boys not to travel in groups.
Do you find everything really new and different here?
Yes.
A lot of, do you have a lot of freedom here that you didn't have?
S-U-D-A-N.
What does that mean? What does it mean?
It's a country where I came from. So it's a country of black people, you know. They look black, all of them. You go there, you cannot find white men.
Okay, so, you know, this piece is here so we can demonstrate that, you know, these little things that we do every day have cultural meaning, right? For example, there's an appropriate way to eat something, right? Sometimes if we travel, we have to learn the appropriate way to eat something, you know. And with work, it's no different, right? How we value work, right? Like for instance, you know, I can ask you what comes first, your family or work? Depending on where you are globally, you might have a different answer. You know, work always comes first, family always comes first, or maybe even how you've been socialized in this nation, right? Now, as far as this clip, I believe that the American, the area in the United States that these Sudanese, young Sudanese men were taken to was a suburb outside of Pittsburgh. However, Van, who's in our control room, also wanted to share that, you know, one thing that folks don't realize is that just as we kind of looked at these Sudanese men in this video and, you know, those folks in the supermarket looked at them in a strange way, like, oh, what the heck are you doing? When we travel as, you know, who we are, you know, as Americans, you know, people look at us the same way. You know, he mentions the baseball cap, right? How this is a very American thing. And if someone's wearing a baseball cap, you know, traveling through Europe, the assumption is that they're American, or, you know, style of dress, etc., right? So there's an interchange there. Emilio also writes in, you know, he's discussing social status. Social status holds a big influence on youth or anyone being compensated for labor, one is producing in work. Would you think this will hold true in the future if and when the economy rises? Social status is always going to be there. You know, it's kind of how our stratification system works. So, you know, as long as we have the type of economy where, that we have, so the level of compensation will keep reproducing class. So, you know, definitely it's going to still be a status symbol, right? You know, the more money you have, you know, the more important you are, you know, according to our culture. And, you know, again, you know, it's the same reason people buy a Rolex. It's not to tell time, but so people know you have a Rolex. Silvana writes in, watching the video reminds me how grateful we should be here in the United States. Also how we take things for granted. You know, maybe so, right? We have a lot of luxuries here, and, you know, kind of bringing it back to work, right? The expectations that we have as far as work or the occupations that we're going to take in, you know, might not necessarily, you know, depend on having to grow our own food or having to work in a mine or XYZ. Most of us, you know, because, you know, our economy is shifting to a service-based one, most of us maybe expect to sit in an office, air conditioned in front of a computer, right? So, you know, different situations bring about different problems. So, you know, depending on, the geographic region, culture, you know, it's going to be structured a different way. And again, we'll talk about structure. It's the opportunities as well as the constraints that shape the types of jobs we can pursue and by whom, and who can pursue these jobs, and the returns that they will receive, right? So even work has a structure, right? The type of economy, right? You know, like very few people, you know, can take a small piece of land and maybe, you know, be successful from it. Or a better way to think about it is, you know, there are jobs that, you know, will allow you upward mobility. And then there are other jobs that may not afford you the same opportunities, right? So, you know, and sometimes it's not as just as clear as, okay, how much money you make, but, you know, the structure within maybe an organization for advancement, right? The longevity or the viability of a job, right? Is it going to be there in 20 years? Is it going to be there, is it going to be a lifelong pursuit, right? You know, for most of us, we can expect to change jobs two or three times in a lifetime minimum. Some of you may have already, you know, had two or three jobs, right? Two or three careers, I should say. Not jobs, careers, right? We have Susan who writes in. Just wanted to point out how sad it is to hear that people in the United States are so unfriendly or unapproachable, right? It's one way that we become separated. I mean, that's kind of the city life too. You know, one thing we won't be able to go into detail is, you know, into this idea of solidarity, you know, whether, you know, just to keep it basic, organic or mechanical, but value systems, shift, right? You know, most of us don't speak to our neighbors, but, you know, there's solid reasons for that, right? But unfortunately, you know, we kind of, you know, have to stay on task. But if you tune in on Monday, 4 o'clock, we'll cover some of that or begin to. Emmy writes in, watching the video, not only are we grateful that we have everything they don't, but we also have forgotten the very fundamental importance that they value as a way of life, right? So, you know, right there, Emmy's kind of, you know, pointing out two different perspectives. One, you know, perhaps they don't have the same first, you know, developed world's kind of luxuries, but at the same time, you know, there's far more kinship or communal solidarity there, right? But again, you know, just because, you know, just kind of throw this other idea out there, just because we have kind of these luxuries, these first world luxuries, doesn't necessarily mean that perhaps our lives are better, right? You know, it's all about what you value, right? You know, one of the things that will kind of, you know, one of these ideas that we'll entertain here is that perhaps, you know, working so much, you know, in our society, you know, by doing that, we surrender some of the more human parts of our lives, right? Like, where do you have time to enjoy your family, right? And, you know, everything has its consequences, right? But again, you know, as we move towards, as we move through the class, you know, we'll definitely, you know, get into this. Another concept I want to kind of talk about is agency, right? People's efforts, whether as individuals or in groups, to direct their own biographies, shape their own lives, and respond to and sometimes modify the structure and culture of work, right? This is, agency is your ability to do something, anything, right? And sometimes our agency is kind of constrained by, you know, norms, values, et cetera, right? But everyone has ability, right? You can do things, right? So whether you do something or whether you don't, right? You know, it actually has an outcome, right? You know, and again, you can always call in and, you know, if you rather speak than text in, but either way, you know, your comments are always welcome. But again, you know, agency has an effect on all parts of our lives. But, you know, just to give you an example of work, you know, you have ability to make decisions as you work, right? Well, most of us, you know, we'll talk about alienation, but the decisions you make or will that you consider and whether you act them out or not, you know, influence everything, right, that you do. Whether it's just keeping the same kind of line, the same structure, or kind of shifting things forward. Kat writes in, the ability to approach someone or a house for help or whenever is very neighborhood dependent, right? Pittsburgh has its own issues, different from LA or parts of LA, right? And I mean, the same thing, you know, I don't think Los Angeles would be very different from that suburb, right? We'll talk about race in this class and how, or, you know, on another side, you know, how young people are seen in a society or groups of people, right? You know, so definitely, you know, we're in Los Angeles or elsewhere in the United States, you know, we're just as susceptible. The last concept is the social construction of reality, right? We also have to recognize how we perceive the world or reality, right? And how it shapes the ideas, how ideas, history, and experience shape the world around us, right? One of the things that, you know, I like to remind, you know, all the students I interact with or is that we only perceive what we know as reality, we only perceive it through our two eyes. That's the only reality we have access to. We all come from different places, different backgrounds, and this information, right, this history, these ideas, what we experience, helps us make sense of the world, right? One thing I like to kind of, you know, want you to think about is how you are watching this class. Like, you know, how did you turn on the TV or monitor. Well, you had to learn it, right? This is part of the socialization process. You learn it. In our video, you know, these young men were figuring out how to eat a donut, right? Some of their cultural, you know, traits show up, you know, sharing, things like that. Maybe it's something that we wouldn't do, you know, but even how we eat something, right? Or, you know, you always see this kind of comedy bit reproduced in film, right? You go to a fancy restaurant, you have like 100 utensils in front of you. The reason we can find that little shared experience is that many of us, when we're, you know, most of us just, you know, use a fork, use a spoon, use a knife, right? When we're given so many options, we don't really know what to do, right? I mean, we have a mug here, right? You know, we all kind of understand what the mug is by looking at it, by the shared understanding, the shared knowledge of what it is. But, you know, it's full of liquid or else I'd do something crazy with it. But we can change the meaning to it, right? Like maybe I hold it up to a wall and listen in, right? Now you just learned another use for it, right? It's a hearing piece. So anyway, you know, the important thing to remember throughout this course is that ideas, values, how we see things, and what we consider even as common sense is a social construction, right? It's their ideas, they're created, right? And more importantly, when we get to gender and something like race, right, and stereotypes and things like that, you know, these are ideas, you know, but they're very powerful. They affect and influence who we are, our identity, and how others treat us in the world, right? So anyway, that's the social construction of reality. So Hakim writes in, society is influenced by our culture. Many of the way we do things are based on where we live and how we view culture. If we visit another country that has different cultures, we would find it different as well. So, you know, that's very true, okay? So, we're going to kind of turn back the clock a tiny bit. We're going to talk about what sociology is, right? So we'll give you a short general definition what sociology is. You know, everything we've been doing is sociology. All of you are, to a certain extent, sociologists, right? In order to exist in this world, you have to understand you have to understand the society that you live in. As sociologists, we just take it to the next level. We apply theory to it to frame these things. That way we can develop arguments and kind of discuss, okay, why the world is the way it is or why people do this or that, you know, or why they don't, how they're constrained, how social order is created. So first is, you know, something that's going to be very general. And usually when I like to describe, you know, these theories or perspectives that are lumped in together as kind of like, you know, kind of think about it how we think about food, right? There's a lot of ideas, there's a lot of influence within them, and we're just going to have a little taste, right? So one way to think about it, it's like if we were talking about Mexican food, that might be conflict theory. We'll present an idea or one item on the menu, it's like tacos, right? You can see the influence there, you can see the style there, some of the same ingredients, but does that represent all of, you know, Mexican food, right? No, it doesn't, right? It can be very diverse, very different even within those theories, right? Or those schools of thought, right? Same thing with spaghetti, right? Most of us have had spaghettis, but are SpaghettiOs the same as, you know, I don't know, I'm not that fancy, but lasagna? No, right? Well, I don't even know if you would consider SpaghettiOs Italian food. I know someone at home is probably like, oh, what are you saying? Bad joke, right? Usually I have an audience and they laugh and I know it's okay. But anyway, we're going to go into conflict theory, right? You know, these are based on some of the ideas by Karl Marx. You know, we'll go into Karl Marx in detail. He's very important for work as we go through this class. But the key ideas within conflict theory is conflict and the potential for conflict underlie all social relationships, right? One way we see it in work is that, you know, again, we discuss selling labor, right? But in order to create a surplus value or profit, you have to sell your labor. So, you know, you're always trying to get a better price than someone, you know, than what you're, what the person who's buying your labor is trying to buy it for. So, you know, right there, there's conflict, there's, you know, again, exploitation. You know, that's kind of the way the economy works. The other part is social change is desirable because of this exploitation, particularly if it can lead to greater equality, right? This is conflict theory. And existing social order reflects the powerful imposing their values and beliefs on the weaker. Inequality and injustice are the sources of conflict. So that's just generally conflict theory, right? We're going to go through a lot of theorists throughout this class, but it's good to kind of talk about the different outlooks that we have. But this is how we explain the world. Now, the quick thing with theory, you know, it doesn't mean it's ideology. Ideology comes from theory, but when we use theory, it's kind of a way to explain why, you know, the relationships are structured the way that they are, or that the structure, social structure is constructed the way it is. We also have structural functionalism, or sometimes just referred to as functionalism, functional theory, I'm sorry. It assumes that the social structure, right, culture and social processes work together to ensure that society runs smoothly and harmoniously, right? So, you know, one of the ways to think about it is kind of like a football team, right? You know, just to give you a very basic, very simple explanation, right? Everyone has a job on a football team. I know it started already, but all the games are tomorrow, so I got football on the mind, right? Anyway, you know, you have a quarterback. His job's very specific. Yeah, he has more prestige than everyone else, but, you know, that's because he's taking more responsibility, you know, you can argue. But everyone on that team is important, right? The linemen, if we're talking about the offense, wide receivers, tight ends, running backs, everyone has a specific job, even the kicker, right? So although not everyone gets the same amount of prestige, right? The whole system, the whole structure wouldn't function without each and every one of those players, right? So society is the same way. We all are interdependent on each other. Right, one way we can think about it is that we all do our jobs, even though we might not see it directly. Like, I lecture and I get paid, right? But I depend on those who work in the supermarket or those who work in a restaurant so I can have something to eat, right? And, you know, maybe way around the line, maybe you work at one of those restaurants, you know, you depend on my labor so you can get your degree and get more money and et cetera. So that's how the system works. It always wants to maintain itself, but we'll kind of explore more of this as we go on. Symbolic interactionism. This is kind of more of a micro. We're looking at the everyday one-on-one interactions and what symbols mean, right? You know, it's often called social construction or imperative theory. It's concerned on how people give meaning to their everyday experiences and how they define and respond to events. People form groups and interact from interacting individuals. Through the interaction, we learn what to expect and how to share common understanding through symbols like language, right? If you really break down language, it's just a bunch of sounds, right? Actually, that's how you learn it, right? You learn that A makes A, right? If you want to say ant, right? You know, you put those sounds together, now you have a word. Ant. Now everyone is thinking of a different ant. That's just kind of like the social construction, right? But you know, we use more words to create more defined ideas. Like I might say common ant or black ant, right? So now everyone's idea of an ant is getting more refined. And then we can tell whole stories, right? So I don't know. I think it's far out if you really think about it, right? We're using all these sounds to create all these very detailed, very complex ideas, right? But it's not only, you know, sounds or these symbols that we call language, written language, but also the clothes you wear, right? You know, one thing that, and I hope I get this right, you know, for men, buttons are on one side and women are, you know, on blouses, they're on the other side, right? That's how you tell between, you know, the two styles or why. You know, you can even ask this, why do men cut their hair a certain way and why are women required, or it's a sign of femininity that, you know, women wear their hair longer. You know, I know men and women can challenge both of these ideas, but even at that, if they challenge it a certain way, you know, they're challenging the social order, right? and we'll talk about deviance. So, you know, all that's underlying, right? Underlying all these things, because this social construction is what makes our world meaningful. Now, to go into how we learn through everyday interaction, again, this is the idea of socialization. We use sanctions or, you know, certain encouraging acts to, you know, understand whether this behavior is acceptable or not. For example, when you're young, you know, you're constantly told what to do and what not to do. You know, through that whole process, you're learning about your role, you know, who you're supposed to be in a society. So, for example, with toys, you know, if you're a young, you know, if you're a, when you were young, or maybe you have children or seen this in children, right? When children play, they might pick up a doll, like a Barbie or something, right? If it's a boy, there's going to be a sanction, right? Don't play with that. That's for girls, right? Right there, you know, your socially construction. Through that process of socialization, that young child just, you know, was taught that, okay, this is for girls. This is feminine. I'm a boy, not a girl. Well, vice versa, you know, a girl might be encouraged to play with them, or, and again, it could be frustrating if you're, you know, for young women, or if you're a woman who experienced this. You know, maybe you don't want to play with dolls. Maybe you do want to play with dinosaurs, and you don't get to because dinosaurs are for boys, right? You know, all this is, you know, existing in our world. So again, you know, these things have symbols, and they affect agency, they affect identity, they affect who we are and how we feel about ourselves. So again, you know, human agency is creating the social environment stressed in this approach. The last is rational choice, right? Or exchange theory. And this is for the most part how kind of economists construct the world, and kind of the theory that we're most of us are familiar with. People make choices on utilitarian factors, right? And utilitarianism is all, you know, you maximize your rewards and minimize the cost. So you seek pleasure. Well, it sounds a little Freudian, but you minimize pain or displeasure and you seek pleasure. You try to maximize your pleasure, right? Now, you know, it's not just pleasure, but one way to kind of think about it is, you know, you go to the market, and, you know, you so many soups there. You go to the soup aisle, there's all these soups. How do you choose the one that you want, right? Well, cost might go into it. You might find the one that, you know, saves you the most money, or maybe the one that you get the most soup for, right? We'll talk about how we rationalize it, but just to keep it simple, you know, you're always trying to maximize your rewards and minimize the costs. So all social behavior is viewed as an exchange. You know, even when you say hello, right? You know, we think of it as polite, as normative. It's what you do. But if you don't say hello and it's the wrong or right person, they're going to be pissed off at you, right? So, you know, there's a cost, right? Or if you tell a person hello, maybe this is, you know, this will remind you of your high school years, or if you're in high school, you know, this is one of the explanations why this happens, right? Some people are seen as, you know, more stigmatized than others. So, you know, if you have a nerdy cousin, and, you know, they always say, oh, I was a nerdy cousin. So anyway, so they ask you, oh, why don't you say hi to me at high school? And, you know, say, well, I don't want people to laugh or know that you're my cousin. Well, see, right there, you had an exchange, right? Someone was trying to minimize the cost, and even though it's really messed up, you know, they were trying to protect their identity. So anyway, and with rational choice, the assumption is always that social behavior is motivated by self-interest, right? We'll break these down as we go on, but some of the, you know, like conflict theory doesn't necessarily, or structural function doesn't necessarily agree with this whole idea of self-interest. So anyway, let's talk about the emergence of work. Since the emergence of human work, work and how we understand and view it has changed, right? So work has changed through, like we mentioned before, through the whole spectrum or timeline of human civilization, right? What we do is not the same as what our great, 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 great grandfathers and mothers did, or even, you know, one generation past. Like, perhaps, you know, your grandfather worked at a cannery, you know, maybe your father worked at a cannery, but maybe all the canneries are gone, so maybe you can't do that anymore, right? So, you know, even in personal biographies, you know, what we expect to do and what we end up doing as far as work shifts, changes, right? So first we'll talk about gathering and hunting societies, right? Now, we kind of, in this class, we're going to switch around, you know, the what we're used to. Usually we say hunting and gathering, and at times I might even say hunting and gathering, but we want to put more emphasis on gathering. Gathering is actually more than likely what most people did day to day, right? Hunting takes longer, it's more tedious, and its success is not dependable and probably erratic, right? If you've gone fishing, you might know this, right? If you're like me, you've gone to a lot of trips and came back home with nothing, not even a picture, right? Okay, so, you know, gathering was much more efficient and effective. So, you know, hunting and gathering was basically gathering fruits, plants, insects, scavenging, and hunting game to sustain life, right? Very different from what we experience today, right? Usually if we hunt or gather, you know, most of us don't do it as a necessity. You know, some parts inside of our nation, people do that. It's part of their regular diet. When we explore the developing world, or what's referred to as the third world, and, you know, it usually ends up being more of their diet, right, depending on where they are, right? But again, that's kind of the shifts, and it has to do with development and things like that. But this is important because through this stage, humans developed, you know, how to, you know, there's cooperation skills, which basically, you know, were founded on verbal and nonverbal communication, which we still practice, especially in hunting, right? And it defined what human life, work defined human life, right? Even back then, right? Human evolution coincided with technological innovations like fire, you know, the development of tools and weapons, you know, like the arrowhead, right? Different kinds of bows, right? Even as we advance and look at agrarian society, we'll see that, you know, society was tied to, again, more technological innovations. Even today, right? The internet has shaped how our economy has changed. You know, something that we'll explore later on. Some folks feel that the most important innovation of the last century was not the internet, was not television, was not, jets, planes, cars, but the container, right? The shipping container, because it allowed shipping to be extremely cost effective, essentially very, very cheap, right? Or inexpensive, and thus, you know, opened the doors to a global market, right? Where, you know, folks could take advantage of labor regardless of its geographic location. So, going on to the next topic with gathering hunting societies, most people devoted little time to meeting their, you know, subsistence needs, right? You know, once the gathering was done, it kind of took place fairly quickly. So it's assumed that most folks, you know, spent, you know, a good chunk of their time, you know, meeting their needs, but also they had a good chunk of time where they spent it, or the majority was spent pursuing leisure activities. So, you know, affluence was measured by the ability of abundant leisure rather than the accumulation of material possessions, right? One of the things to remember about hunting and gathering groups, usually they were nomadic, it's assumed they were nomadic, and personal belongings would only hinder their ability to move. So right there, you know, something like private property, you know, chances are it was either non-existent or very rarely practiced. Because again, you know, if you're gonna carry around, like imagine if you had to carry all your stuff around, right? It'd be some of you would think it's seemingly impossible, right? Well, I got to take my TV, my bed. You know, you can't carry that stuff, especially if you have, you know, nowhere to kind of, if you have to keep going, you know, on the move. But again, you know, that's kind of connecting, you know, how the value system is not only connected to work, but to the circumstances that survival, you know, asks for. Gathering and hunters societies were collectively organized. They shared resources within the group, and they cared for group members who were unable to care for themselves due to illness, disability, or misfortune. You know, just another kind of fact to kind of think about it. Even in hunting, gathering and hunting societies, infanticide was probably very common, right? Infanticide is, you know, basically the killing of infants, right? Because again, you know, a child, if, you know, the group wasn't ready, would be a hindrance or keep them, you know, bound to a certain other area that would maybe put the group as a whole at risk. So anyway, one of the groups that we kind of look at in the modern world is the Kung San. They're, you know, from the sub-Saharan part or Saharan parts of Africa, but they're not the only nomadic group. That's kind of how we kind of, you know, get our ideas of what gathering and hunting groups were from some of the few societies that still practice it and are still in existence, right? Again, you know, when the whole world was doing it, when all human society was doing it, you know, there was no, concrete record of it. So most of what we're, you know, all we can really do is make educated guesses about how folks were living, okay? Now, what we'll do is actually, we'll take a quick interlude before we go into agricultural labor, and we'll look at Mongolia and the way nomadic life is changing today. Now, you will see a lot of modernity in these situations, but the reason we're going to watch this is that, you know, the way people live, it's being, again, challenged by, the ever-changing world. And, you know, this change is something that, you know, has always, changed society. Actually, we won't take a break. And actually, this is probably the last video we'll see today. After that, you know, we'll go and talk about work and time and a little bit about the agricultural change just lightly. So after this, just to kind of give you a look at nomadic life. So we'll see you back in about 6 minutes. And then we'll kind of wrap up the class, okay?
Basan Hu still lives in a traditional Mongolian ger, or yurt, but she's given up her old nomadic life. For the past year, her ger has been based in just one place, in one of the sprawling shanty towns surrounding the capital, Ulaanbaatar. Like many people living here, Basan Hu used to raise animals on Mongolia's steppes. But that life is growing harder and harder because of economic pressures, environmental changes, and a string of devastating winters that killed off huge herds of livestock a decade ago. Since then, hundreds of thousands of nomadic herders have packed up and moved here to look for work. Basan Hu came to the city to live with two of her sons after her husband died. She gets a $50 a month pension, and one son has found construction work, so the family is getting by. But she admits that if her husband were alive, he never would have agreed to leave the countryside and their old way of life. Life on the city's outskirts is not easy, but it's become a typical way of life for Mongolians. With the influx of migrants like Basan Hu and her family, Ulaanbaatar's population has ballooned. Makeshift houses and gers now fill what used to be grassland. Now more than half of the people in the capital, or one in every five Mongolians, live in these suburban ger districts without basic sanitation or infrastructure. There are some signs of improvement here. One kindergarten is being built with Japanese aid. The World Bank funds clean water projects, and residents can apply to own the land where they've settled. But unemployment is high, and conditions are particularly bad in winter, when the air is full of thick smoke from the homes heated with burning coal and garbage. This is another force that's reshaping Mongolia. The mining industry is booming. Foreign and Mongolian firms dig for coal, copper, uranium, and gold, like here at the Canadian-owned Boro gold mine. For Mongolians struggling to make a living off the land, these jobs are a godsend. At Boro, miners earn $800 a month, compared to an average $60 in construction work. But there are far more Mongolians seeking work than there are mining jobs. In Sunkhara, a town whose economy was badly hurt during the privatization rush of the 1990s, some of the urban poor have turned instead to illicit mining, alongside former herders from the countryside. These so-called ninja miners dig for gold with minimal tools and no official rights to the land. One NGO here is working to help the ninja miners form collectives and adopt safer mining practices. An employee, Tuya Damdimjants, explains why so many people have gone into this risky line of work, including her husband, Batur Tene. Their family's entire herd died in the harsh winter of
1998.
At the end of a long dirt road about 3 hours north of Ulaanbaatar, ninja miners have set up a gold mining camp. They can expect to earn $5 or $10 a day for backbreaking work in the pits or for trying to isolate the gold using dangerous chemicals like mercury and cyanide. Ironically, the mining industry, a last recourse for many former herders, is only making it harder for those who still raise animals for a living. Both official and unofficial operations use huge amounts of water, diverting rivers and leaving large stretches of pasture land unusable. Once this site is depleted, the ninja miners will break camp and look for gold elsewhere. It's a new kind of nomadic life, and one that offers no more certainty than they had before. At White Lake, Saga Nur, outside the city of Darkhan, it's horse branding day. The Buddhist calendar says it's an auspicious day to tame animals, and men from three families are pitching in with the hard work. They all live in a more or less traditional way here, raising livestock and moving to different pastures throughout the year. Even with all the migration to the cities, some 40% of Mongolians still live as nomadic herders. But for Dolgor Ma and her family, life has changed too. They moved here, near the city, from remote Gobi Altai province because they were too far from any markets. And that's another trend for many of Mongolia's herders, who can only keep making a living if they adapt to the changing economy. Living near a city, Dolgor Ma's family now gets twice the price for their camel's milk, and her son, Shinbayer, can go to school nearby in Darkhan. And that might mean a better future for him. But that's no longer guaranteed in a changing Mongolia, where urban life and mining are steadily replacing rural life. For now, at least, this family is able to keep its traditions alive, and Shinbayer's future seems wide open.
So an excellent snapshot of how economic shifts, cultural shifts have affected not only this one family's life and expectations for that life, but also whole communities, right? So again, you know, work is just part of that, but it influences so much more than, you know, this is what you do and this is what you get paid for, right? Everything's connected, even for that young child at the end. What he will be is being, you know, and how he's going to pursue it is being shaped by, you know, these new cultural expectations, these new realities that perhaps, you know, his father didn't entertain or his grandfather didn't entertain. But again, shifts in how folks are living. A little bit about the agricultural age. Unfortunately, we don't have as much time to, you know, discuss it, right? But, you know, the same technological shifts that, you know, helped people rise out of the era of gathering and hunting also helped create, you know, cities and states, right? You know, we're going to kind of discuss a little bit about the emergence of the state, but innovations in agricultural production, planting crops and the maintenance of livestock gave rise to the state because now folks were able to produce more. Now, all the work was a whole lot more labor intensive than it is today, but things like the plow helped give rise to civilization and governance, right? This freed people to pursue other occupations and it supported a ruling elite. So without the, without the agrarian revolution and, human history, you wouldn't see the rise of the state. But it all, with the rise of the state, it also established warfare, right? You know, this is how the elite preserved their interests in the world, right? You know, either you defend it or if you want something, you take it. So, this is how taxation came about, really. It was something that, currency, right? You know, trying to figure out how many eggs compared to oranges that someone has to pay in taxes became difficult. You know, and again, you know, it became difficult to preserve those things across large distances, long distances and, you know, whatnot. So currency became, you know, something that had to be established by the state in order to pay for, the bureaucracy that would, you know, rise. Well, actually, the bureaucracy rose because of this. You know, you had to have a record keeping of who's paying what and where things are going, but also, you know, to support the elites who were ruling those newly emerged states. So, taxation came about, record keeping came about, new kinds of jobs came about because of that. You know, now you had a tax collector, you had an occupation like a soldier, you know, although a lot of the common folks were just inscripted whenever they needed more people. But anyway, new occupations associated with the bureaucracy because of the new established rules, procedures, and hierarchical order. So the rise of the state changed the type of work that needed to be done in the society. It's important to remember just as war fuels our society, you know, this is not something new, right? You know, even in the United States, the war making industry is something that, really propels the economy. You know, when you hear a term like, foreign aid, right? Usually it is, military aid or whatever, it's a way to sell more, American made, weapons or vehicles and things like that. Now, that doesn't mean they get all the same bells and whistles that, the United States Army or any branch of the military has, but, it keeps people employed, right? You know, someone's making those Black Hawk helicopters, someone's making those tear gas canisters that, were shot at protesters, during the Egypt uprising around last year. So, all that, kind of is connected, right? So again, that gave rise to the state, but going back to it, it also gave rise to artisan work because folks were able to depend or interdepend on the labor of others, individuals could pursue full-time specialties like blacksmithing, potter, you know, even, you know, again, state elite, right? Much as the way we do now, you know, I was able to pursue, you know, my education in sociology because, or I'm able to keep this job because I don't have to go out and farm or hunt or gather any of the food I need. I just, you know, exchange my money for it, right? And, you know, most of us do the same thing, you know. Same thing with soldier, right? You know, if you're fighting people or keeping order, you know, you don't have time to farm or hunt, right? So you have, you know, you get paid a wage and you exchange that. So you start to see where this interdependence starts to emerge because of this artisan work, you know. And again, this gave rise to independent artisans and merchants and gave rise to early capitalism and a debt system. So, you know, we will try to explore that a little bit more next week. Going back to something that we kind of started off talking about is this concept of time and work. Time is a concept. It's a measurement, if you really think about it, right? But it's very important, right? We measure our day. It helps us keep track of how much, you know, we're going to earn between this and that, right? It's just a measurement, right? It helps coordinate us, right? Again, like I mentioned before, you know, since it's almost the end of the class, you know, we're going to stop at a certain time, but like we began at a certain time. Work is coordinated that way, not only within, like, say, a factory or one workplace, but it's coordinated globally. Some of you might work or be associated in a field that works with, you know, financial instruments or the stock exchange, right? You know, if you're on the West Coast, you have to start trading around 6:30. You probably are awake well before that, but that's when the stock exchange opens in New York. Or there's a reason most businesses open around the same time, right? Because there's that not only interdependence, but, you know, trade is happening at that same, you know, during that same period, right? You know, everyone, you know, if we didn't have this, if we didn't have time to coordinate, you know, you can imagine how chaotic it would be, right? You know, saying, oh, okay, well, even measuring the sun is a way of keeping time, but, you know, that's kind of the point, right? You know, it's a shared understanding of, you know, when people are supposed to be there. It helps coordinate tasks, right? So, you know, work is organized around this. In complex societies, you know, time, you know, is everything, right? You know, even you could even think about labor. We sell our time, you know, from this time to this time, you know, that's what I'm giving up, right? When we look at or think about, you know, the 8-hour day, which, you know, unions and, you know, workers, you know, had to fight over, you know, 20 years to earn that, you know, the argument was, you know, 8 hours of work, 8 hours of leisure, and 8 hours of, you know, sleep. So, you know, breaking the day up, you know, efficiently like that. You know, so it's just beyond the invention of artificial timepieces, and, you know, it's really sharing collective schedules, right? Also, when we get to the Industrial Revolution, we see, you know, machinery, you know, kind of set at the same kind of pace, and, you know, the necessity to schedule work so everything works accordingly. Now, the last thing that we'll deal with, and this is kind of an example to show you how value systems, and this is something that we've been discussing the whole time, influence not only work, but how we, you know, value our, you know, how we construct our identity, or how we, or how value systems help support or fuel economic systems, right? We're going to talk about Max Weber and we're going to discuss Max Weber and the Protestant ethic, you know, so Protestantism and the rise of capitalism. But before we start, I'd like to share something that Shauna just wrote in. Jobs are organized which must be coordinated, and these are the way the tasks get done and we get paid. So absolutely, right? If something's late, you know, maybe you don't get paid. If you're late, you know, like me, I'm sometimes always late, you know, I get in trouble and I'm stigmatized. So, you know, just a few moments, you know, we're just going to talk about Protestantism. But again, this is in your text. And if you have any questions about it, you know, this is an old writing, you know, at the turn of the last century. So you can definitely read about it independently. So our society holds values about work and capital, right, wealth, that influence our behavior, how we view time, money, and our labor. For example, most of us are familiar with this term, time is money, right? So we only have 3 minutes left, so time is money. So when Max Weber wrote about the spirit of Protestantism, right, he was kind of making a connection between Calvinist values and how, you know, what led him to kind of investigate this was that, you know, Germany, England, and the United States were all industrializing before some of the older nations like Spain, Italy. You know, Italy had the Renaissance and all that. So, you know, this was a good question, like, why did this happen, where it happened? So what Max Weber kind of argues is that the Protestant value system that, you know, was religious, rooted in religion, you know, and rooted in religion was what, you know, helped fuel capitalism, because it made successful capitalists that, although you weren't Calvinist or a Protestant, their success was something that was to be copied, right? And, you know, there were, you know, the value system had, you know, don't waste your money, right? Basically, Catholics would, you know, give to charity or throw big parties on Sundays. The Protestants didn't like this. You know, if you remember Martin Luther and the Reformation, that was one of the arguments then that you can buy salvation as well. But, you know, you saved your money. But say if you couldn't give it away, you couldn't spend it on luxuries, you only could do one thing, is that that's reinvested in your business, right? The other thing is that you know, didn't lend money. You worked hard, you know, working was next to godliness. So you can see with all these, like, these ideas that we have about hard work, about not wasting time, you know, even though we're not, most of us, you know, aren't Calvinists, we all share this same value system. And this value system was something that made people successful. And when people saw this success, people copied it, right? Who doesn't want to be successful? Now, you know, what was rooted in, you know, a religion's, a person whose religion, you know, made them anxious about their own damnation, is something that over time became a set of values that, you know, became good at, you know, propelling capitalism, right? You know, and this guilt associated with idleness is something that many of us still maintain. But, you know, just to kind of play devil advocate, you know, Weber's thesis, you know, is can't be conclusively proven. And, you know, time may have been more decisive than that, you know. But that's just part of it. You know, if you have your text, definitely read up on it. But that's it for today. Thank you for joining us. And we'll be back next week with more Sociology of Work. Till next time, goodbye.